So let's start with you.
Yeah.
Are you just a naturally happy Canadian who decided to come to Hollywood?
I'm a naturally happy Canadian. Yes. I guess that might be true, actually. I think I might be a naturally happy Canadian. I've always probably erred on the side of a little over-animated. I've heard that one since I was young. But yes, Canadian, generally pretty happy. Also, I love coming to work. Mm-hmm. So, I tend to be more happy than not.
Well, what was your route to, I'm going to get end up in Hollywood directing and producing?
I guess the somewhat short story, grew up in Montreal, started doing theater when I was like 9 or 10. Mm-hmm. And I had this very kind
as
of...
As an actor?
As an actor, yeah. No one's
not as a director.
I wish.
Very precocious.
Story. I feel like someone like the Duffer Brothers do have a story of directing short films
as children.
In the bedroom as yeah. children. No, I was not directing prepubescently. I started doing theater at 10 years old. I asked my theater teacher, what is the school to go to for theater? And she said, Yale. And so I decided at a ridiculously young age that I was going to go to Yale. I worked my ass off and foregoed a lot of fun mm-hmm. in high school, I think, in retrospect, which might have been a mistake. Because now I'm like a middle-aged guy still yearning for the wildness of youth that I never had. But did get into Yale, went to Yale, and while I was at Yale, I was still acting, but I started directing. And in my senior year, I directed Paul Giamatti in Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. And it was very clear to me two things. A, Paul was a great actor, and I was always going to just be pretty good. Mm-hmm. And B, it was really kind of gratifying to kind of design the whole thing, to be in charge of the whole thing, and to kind of feel that thrill of directing. And so that was the beginning. And so... finished Yale, came out here, still acted a bit on like 90210 and things that are on the internet. Mm-hmm. And I will make it easier for viewers by giving titles, Zombie Nightmare. And went to USC Film School, made a short film, and then literally it was that film school fantasy where like the morning after my short film screened, my career started.
And was it a comic film?
It was. It was called Broken Record. I literally still have the invitation in a frame here in my office from many years ago. Two teens who live in a town where nothing exceptional ever happens get married to get into the Guinness Book of World Records in an attempt to have one thing that is special that is their own. And all my friends, it's the mid-90s, so all my friends are making like Tarantino derivations and Pulp Fiction knockoffs and... this was a kind of entertaining, fun, funny, warm-hearted comedy. And I was mocked by my classmates at USC because it was so...
That's not
us. No, they weren't. No, I mean, it was all... I'm choosing to remember it as good-natured comedy.
Well, you weren't shooting for Ben Well. You were shooting for...
And it was the craziest thing because I'll never forget that screening. It was like drama. Drama. This was at like the where they screened like 9 student films one night, and Broken Record played, and it just kind of lit things up, and the next day everything began.
So that's, I guess, now we know how you got Paul Giamatti to wear blue face.
That is why when I finally got my first movie, which was Big Fat Liar, first decision I made was I want Paul Giamatti to play Marty Wolf and get dyed blue in his swimming pool.
Were you a cocky young guy who thought you knew what you were doing?
No.
Or did you feel
even
like you were...
as a director?
Yeah.
No, I don't think I've ever been cocky. I'm
confident.
I've always been confident. But actually, that's even... like, I'm not confident in settings or activities where I'm not good. I can only feel confident if I feel that I can do a thing better or more well-suitedly than anyone else. And so, to this day, I only direct movies that I think I can direct better than anyone else. And frankly, it's why our slate is divided into stuff that we develop for me and stuff that's, you know, like when we read the story for Arrival, mm-hmm. I knew early that there was gonna be other filmmakers who would be better suited to that. And that's why we developed it as producers rather than for me to direct. So never cocky, but if I know I'm dialed into something tonally, I guess I'm confident.
Okay. No, I'm just trying to, was there an evolution as to how you saw yourself as a director in terms of your skill set?
Well, it's still ongoing, right? Like, I've made 11 movies, and interestingly, I never set out to be a comedy director. I got successful as a comedy director, and I made a series of movies that all did well, and so then I was like, oh, I guess I'm a successful comedy director, and you can scream to the heavens, no, 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 I'm more than that. Mm-hmm. I'm different than that, but, I mean, we're all pigeonholed, but especially if you get publicly successful at something, you're extra pigeonholed, and so I became the family-friendly comedy guy. Mm-hmm. It's why I did Real Steel, which was not a comedy. It's why I did This Where I Leave You, which I didn't make for commercial reasons. I just loved that novel. And yet, interestingly, it's as a production company and as producers that I've been able to disrupt that perception more than I've been able to thus far as a director. It may or may not ever happen as a director. And the truth is I like directing popcorn movies. Mm-hmm. But I love producing a broader range of tones and genres.
Well, I think one of the things that you've been most tagged with as a director is the loyalty of talent. I mean, Steve Martin signed off on you, essentially.
Yeah, no.
People kind of went, oh, he must know something.
It was when Steve Martin asked me to do Pink Panther on the heels of Cheaper by the Dozen. That was, and also that's when I realized, like, this notion of repeat business, you know, that means it went well. That means the trust was accrued, and I'm proud of that. So, you know, I've done a couple with Amy Adams now. I've done several with Steve Carell, Steve Martin, obviously three with Ben Stiller, and a number of other ones. And I guess I really try to, I don't approach it like a job. Like, I want to create a really intimate, collaborative experience. And we work really hard to do that. So yeah, when an actor or a writer or a filmmaker wants to work with us repeatedly, that feels good because that means we accomplished our goal.
So were the two Dans a shift in your work life? I mean, is that as
well,
a producer?
Well,
was
Dan
that...
Levine, you, who is here, and Dan Cohen, who will be the talking hand here. But I've got. I guess this might be offensive to others who would make this claim, but I actually believe empirically that I have the best executive staff and fellow producers of any production company that any of us can name. And it was part of a shift that started, how many years ago, Dan?
Seven?
Six years. Where I've had this deal for like 10 years, 21 Laughs has been a company for like 10 and a half years. And for the first three or four of them, I would tell people, no, we're gonna be more than you think. We're going to be different than you think, and it's going to be way more than comedy, and definitely more than family comedy. And people would, like, nod politely, and that would be that. But when Dan joined the company, which was when I was doing the motion capture of the boxing robots, they weren't robots, they were fighters, on Real Steel, our first meeting was on the mocap stage down in Playa del Rey. And we met, and I knew that we'd get along. I knew that Dan has a internal solidity that I lack. It's already, I think, maybe apparent to the viewers. but I was really clear that we're going to develop stuff for me, but we're going to develop a lot more. And then Dan Cohen joined, I feel like, maybe a year later. But again, I always said, I want the benefit of your tastes, your instincts. And the truth is, Dan Levine and Dan Cohen, like, they love science fiction. They love character-driven science fiction and a variety of genre. And I've never needed to hold on to the credit. I've never needed to hold on to the experience. I wanted us three to build something. And finally now, in this year where we have Arrival and Stranger Things, I feel like I can stop screaming to the rooftops what 20 Laps is, because hopefully it's now a little more self-evident.
So how was it for you coming into this? When was it kind of like, here's an opportunity to try to do dramas at a studio level, or,
you know, you're always looking for, with a director, that director who's also entrepreneurial and is a great producer and gets the bigger picture, because a lot of great directors are focused on what are they doing next. And Shawn was a rarity. And I remember that first time he met, he had an immense appetite and just an incredible bandwidth for all types of movies, which was incredibly empowering to me. And the whole goal was to come in, because Shawn was going to get movies, whether we homegrew them, which is always a victory, or from outside. He didn't rely on us to get him his next movies. People are always coming to him. But our goal initially is, let's try to find things for Shawn, but let's also find things for many filmmakers. If Shawn's off somewhere in Michigan doing a movie, let's be doing two other movies with two other directors elsewhere. And this really started, you know, Arrival is a 5 years, it's been five and a half years, and we knew that we hoped would be our calling card. That if we could get this movie going, people will understand what we're capable of. And it took a little longer, but everything happened for a reason. We're so thrilled with the film. And Stranger Things just happened to be something that came about and happened way faster. And so it's kind of nice that they're coming out at the same time.
No, I like that. It's like, it's not an accident. It's what we've been working on for several years. I don't try to conceal my ambitions as a producer. Mm-hmm. I couldn't conceal them if I actually wanted to. And it's really fun for us, like, to get the experience of working with Denis Villeneuve, who knows what he's doing, who is, frankly, a master in the making, who, what is this, his fourth or fifth movie, to have that experience and to find a way to be additive and collaborative to that kind of filmmaker, at the same time as I'm working with the Duffer brothers, who are 32 and had never, you know, created a series, and everything in between. John Hamburg doing Why Him, and Richie Keene doing Fist Fight, and that was his first movie. And I have to say, directors, it's interesting, because every once in a while I'll go to an event at the DGA, and it'll be like a bunch of movie directors there. And we always say, why don't we hang out more? Directors never get to hang out with other directors, because there can be one quarterback. And so in every movie, there is one quarterback. There's one director. Part of the fun of producing for me, and I think our experiences is probably really different, but for me, it's interesting to see that there's all different modalities to the job, and that the way Denis runs his set, or the Duffers run their set, is going to be different than the way I do it. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, I found it inspiring, and I know it's rubbed off on me and been influential on me.
So how did Denis fit this into his schedule, or how did this all
work? It's amazing, because his schedule is incredibly jam-packed. He does film, he's done, I think, 4 or 5 in a row.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a case where we were trying to get this movie going. And
but I have to give you credit, Dan, because Dan Levine, Dan Cohen, we believe in taking generals, you know, which is the term for a general meeting with no agenda. Mm-hmm. And we will take a general with anyone we think is talented, regardless of whether it fits in with something we have in mind.
Mm-hmm.
So we saw Incendie, which was an early film of Denis. No one had seen Prisoners. Sicario didn't exist. But we see this Quebecois filmmaker and his movie Incendie. I'm from Quebec, and Denis and I knew each other.
So that's why Sean's pronouncing it correctly.
Yes, that is Incendie.
The only person in Hollywood
that's
does
right.
So, yeah.
And not Denis Villeneuve, but Villeneuve.
If you're from L.A., you'd be...
Yes, no, so I'm a fellow Montrealer like Denis. And, but Dan and Dan took a meeting with Denis before he was... I mean, he was nominally on anyone's map.
He actually hadn't even started Prisoners. He was about to go and do Prisoners at the time.
Yeah, and then he happened to mention, I'm interested in science fiction. Here was a guy who hadn't even made a large-scale movie at that time. And in a crazy kind of twist of fate, how we're like at around the same time, a little bit prior.
We had actually met with the writer of Arrival, Eric Heiser, probably a few weeks before, and he had told that we'd spent 2 hours with him trying to find something.
And this was another general with a writer who at that time was known as a horror film writer.
And we couldn't figure it out, but we really connected. And on the way out, he was in the doorway. We always remember this. And we said, have you read anything you like? And he said, you know what? There's this great book of short stories, sci-fi short stories by this writer, Ted Chiang, no one's heard about. So we read that book, read Story of Your Life, which is what Arrival's based on. We're blown away, and we're in the and had just tracked down the writer, Ted Chiang, who had no agent, no lawyer, who had a day job. And so when Denis said to us, I've been dreaming of doing sci-fi, we said, we just found the story. We don't have the rights, so don't tell anyone, but could you read this?
And in the meantime, and it was literally, so like, we told Denis, read this, but we didn't control this, right? Over here, Ted Chiang is saying to Dan, well, how would I know the movie's going to be great? And we give Ted Chiang, the writer, Denis' movie, Incendie. We didn't have any hold on Denis. We didn't have any hold on the story. But we were able to kind of entice, frankly, both sides to build something and bring it together. And that is the genesis of this movie. And we told Denis, we said, go do your movie. He then went to do Sicario. We said, there's going to be a full movie ready to go when you come up for air.
Yep.
And it was our job to build it, cast it, finance it, and get distribution all by the time Denis became available post-Sicario, and that's what we did.
And you were here in the Fox lot in your office.
We are here in the Fox lot.
And the movie is not a Fox movie.
Are you observing that it's not a Fox movie?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I've had this deal, 20 laps in at Fox, for its entire life. they, I mean, the lights are on because Fox pays the electricity bill, and they pay for our company. The deal is, it's a first look deal, so they have a right to hear everything that we're thinking of working on first. If it's not for them, frankly, they're very generous and flexible, and I appreciate this fact that, like, when we went to them with, I guess at that point, it was the short story and the writer, and they're like, you know what, we don't see us making that. And so we had the freedom to go and try and give life to it elsewhere. We've done that a few times. Fist Fight is at New Line. And, you know, we've
been... Alexander
and the Terrible, long title. that one, we went to Disney because it was well-suited to Disney. So I would say, you know, I'm all for making more movies here at my home studio, but I also am really grateful for the fact that if it's not for them, we go make it elsewhere. And sometimes we go make it elsewhere at another studio, and increasingly... we find ways outside of the studio to get the financing and put it together and make it exactly what we want as 21 Labs, and then find a distributor.
As a director and producer, you've been through the budget wars of the 2000s, 2010s. Do you feel like it's changed? I mean, you're obviously getting great stuff made, but...
Yeah, but the wars, first of all, the wars have always existed. The grind has always existed.
But there weren't $100 million comedies until... 2002 and...
Well, I mean, look, I mean, for me, I mean, it's interesting because it's been said to me many times, like, Night at the Museum probably doesn't get made in 2016. It was not a known title. It was not IP that people had branded an awareness of. It was not a best-selling book. It was an unknown children's book. And I'll tell you what's changed. Certainly, budgets have gotten more stringent, but what's really gotten more restrictive is green lights. Green lights at studios, especially among larger movies, 75, I mean, this is not a statistic, this is me making up a number, but like, let's say this, the vast majority of the movies that all studios are making are superheroes, fairy tales, or some pre-awareness title that allows executives to sleep better on a Friday night of opening weekend. And so, if you want to get other stuff made, whether big or small, increasingly it takes levels of persistence that are like soul-draining but imperative, and or it requires a certain kind of lateral thinking so that if it's not going to happen in a studio, okay, who's got money, who's looking to do something that's a little smaller or more mid-scale, and I could give you several examples of movies we're shooting right now where... wasn't for a studio, we went out, we found another way. And that, to me, increasingly, is the job of being a producer, is you find another way. You find a freaking way. When, you know, and it's forced me, it's interesting, because I've had my whole career as a director at the studios. Even my small movie, my Jonathan Tropper, This Where I Leave You movie, was a Warner Brothers studio movie for $19.3 million. So I am a studio guy as a director, but increasingly as producers, we are finding other moves to make.
But you're right in that the $40 to $90 million movies sort of vanished.
Yeah.
You know, that under 40 or that big budget, you know, Marvel or, you know, superhero or based on a best-selling book, those movies get the big dollars, but that medium-range budget has vanished.
So is that, does that bother you, or is it just a matter of figuring out how to make a movie for it's 40 instead of 75?
I mean, both.
Yeah.
Honestly, for me, I'd say both. It bums me out because I do think there's a market for it, and I do like working with studios, and I know how to do that. It bums me out that it's just the pie has shrunk, the pie is more restrictive, but it really forces kind of an industriousness and a creativity to where you're going to find the money. But definitely, look, we grew up as moviegoers in the 80s and the 90s, and there was a range of films that now wouldn't get made. Would Dead Poets get made? Would Rain Man get made? Would Good Will Hunting get made? Like, they probably get made as independents.
Cheaper, yeah.
Cheaper?
Well, they were mostly independents, actually. And, think about Miramax.
Look, Miramax certainly had a very specific niche, but our business has changed. But I am happy to say, like, look, Arrival is a mid-range budget. I've had people assume the movie cost $80, $90 million.
Don't correct them.
I'm not going to correct it. Nor will I say more. But anyway, it's definitely like, as our business changes, if you want to stay prolific and relevant as a producer, you have to like hide your head in the sand is a death sentence. You have to kind of acknowledge the shift, acknowledge the evolution, and evolve with it.
So what is the story with Stranger Things with you guys?
Stranger Things, it was the first year in a decade that I said to myself, I'm not going to direct this year. I'm going to pass. I'm going to not do, because like, certainly look, the most frequent offers are family films. They come in almost every week, and I've done three night museums. It's been good to me. I hope I've been good to it, but I wanted something different. And I decided to be a little bit more in my life and a little bit more in the bloodstream of the labs. And that's what we call Twitter labs, the labs. And people who work here are called labsters. These are little known secrets now.
Are there dollar bills everywhere? Or no,
this, no, none of that. But Dan Cohen comes into this office one day and says, stop what you're doing. Read this spec pilot by two twin brothers that no one's heard of. And I read Stranger Things, and way before I finished it, I knew these guys could write. I bring them in within days. The Duffer brothers, they're sitting on the couch you're sitting on, Dave. And within moments, I knew, oh wait, they not only are writers, they're filmmakers, they're ready. And they were humble, but really, you know, you go back to what you said earlier, like they know what they're doing as filmmakers. And they knew exactly what they wanted the show to be. And so I said to them, look, there's going to be other producers who on paper work more in genre, because at that time, no one knew what Arrival was and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm going to put this one on my back, and it's going to be you guys and 21 Laps, and we're going to get it done. And thank God the Duffers lead with their gut, and they're like, you know what? We think you get this. So let's go. First pitch at a network together. Me and the Duffers is Netflix. They bought it by the next morning. Mm-hmm. We told them the Duffers and I are going to direct all of them ourselves. And it's going to be creepy and character anchored always and set in 1983. And nobody really knew what it was going to be. But as we were making it, I knew it was going to be cool. And I knew, frankly, because it was a tiny group of opinions. I mean, that's the beauty mm-hmm. of Stranger Things. That's the anomaly of Stranger Things. No studio, no huge network infrastructure, mm-hmm. no TV company. It's literally 21 Laps and the Duffer Brothers, and mm-hmm. that's it. And so the show has turned out exactly as we discussed in this room a year and a half ago, and the outcome is beyond, I mean, even in my most inflated dream of how it would turn out, we thought, you know, it might be a little popular, but never this. This has been like, this has really been awesome. This has been very fun.
So how does your ego or your emotional connection as a director versus a producer play?
I mean, the truth is that when I sign up to produce, I know that I'm doing it because I'm betting on another filmmaker. And so, I guess, you know, the reason I'm able to do that is my ego gets plenty fed because I direct a movie every year or two. So, I get my fill. But
is it a different kind of...
Oh, it's radically...
You cannot have an ego as a producer.
Yeah. No, no.
You can't actually just be very unhappy.
No, it's actually a sublimation of ego to produce. Because even if you're a powerful producer who carries a lot of weight... You know, at the end of the day, it is about the director. And guess what? More than most production companies, we get that. And we live by that rule because I am that director. Mm-hmm. And so there's no way that I'm going to disrespect the job and disrespect the filmmaker by trying to exert will or presence beyond certain parameters. I actually, it's funny because at first we were like, well, do you think director's going to want to work for 20 Laps because it's a director-created company? And I'm like, I would actually argue that we give our directors more respect and autonomy because it's what I ask for when I direct. And that's the beauty of it. And that's why it's great to have such range. Like, we are working with Damien Chazelle. Mm-hmm. We're working with Denis Villeneuve. The list is, it goes on. And it's because when you come into the labs, if I'm not directing, it's your show. We're here to help you. We're going to give you our opinions. We're going to be the tip of the spear as far as cutting through a lot of, you know, I read something where the Duffers said, I'm really good at dealing with the bullshit. And it's true. Like, all the things that they need kind of a big brother on Stranger Things, that's my job. That's my job. I read every outline, I read every script, I give them my opinion before it goes to the network, and then everything else, you know, last year it was getting permission to use the Millennium Falcon from Lucasfilm. We went through conventional channels, we got a no. The brothers called me, can you do something? I made a few calls, it became a yes. And there's like, sometimes that's the job of producing, and sometimes it's saying, this script is great in this area, but it needs work here. So it kind of changes day to day, but yeah, it's always ego in the back seat if you're the producer, because you can't do the job well otherwise.
Is it weird to, I mean, Damien is an example, the Duffers are an example, where they've come out of nowhere to some degree and had, you know, are beloved in this kind of amazing way, though their movies don't make that much money or whatever. And you came out and you had this huge success right off the bat and made a lot of money in the films you made.
Yeah.
And don't have that kind of, you know, revered status.
Like, because I've been largely working in family films, like, no one gets anointed in family films. Like, you know, Chris Columbus was never the fancy
guy.
Still
gets shit on all the time.
You know, and like, but it's why it's kind of been fun for me that I get to, obviously, I get to make a nice living and I get to make those big movies. And I love those movies and, you know, that's been very gratifying. But I'm really grateful to the producing career and to this company because I get to scratch different itches. And the truth is, like, once you get over, you know, once you've been at it a little while, you realize it's like, who knows why certain people get kind of benighted with the fancy label early versus not. But in the case of those guys, like, I think they're great filmmakers. I think they deserve it. And, you know, the job, it shifts. I think it shifts project to project, and it is what it is.
And how do you get your jollies?
You know what? It's working really hard in finding material that no one else has found, in finding writers and directors that are just starting out. And honestly, things like Arrival right now is the greatest satisfaction of all. It's something you spent 5.5 years working on has finally gotten to this stage. So it's really championing filmmakers and championing stories and fighting that battle and trying to make things other people aren't making, and getting to the point where you can actually be sitting on a set and saying, because of all that hard work, all these people are sitting here working.
So obviously you'd like Arrival to be a huge, huge mega hit, but but it sounds like you're satisfied even before you find out whether it's going to be a box office.
We definitely want it to be a box office hit, but certainly, like, you know, when we were in Venice at the film festival, and then we were at Telluride, and then we were at Toronto, we started to get a sense of, oh, wow, this is really connecting in a way that feels special. And if you know, and then the reviews started coming out, and like, I didn't even know Rotten Tomatoes made triple digits. Like, and that we're still, as we sit here with you today, still at 100% positive reviews. That I want it to be a hit, but it's already kind of been given immensely.
Every step of the way has been immensely satisfying, and you never know. You could work the saddest thing is you can work 5 years as hard as possible, lose years of your life to film, and it just doesn't connect. So we are especially appreciative right now where people are connecting to this movie. We see people coming out with tears coming down their faces. It's always nice if the critics like your movie, or in this case, love it. So it is immensely rewarding, and we keep hoping.
Well, it's also like we have 5 movies and this TV series, actually 2 TV series in the world this year. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this is what we worked for. As I said, it started off, I named this company because my kid, who I thought was my unathletic kid, who was going to do her school jogathon and run 5-6 laps and then, like, pick dandelions, I assume. She kind of went to this place of will and ran 21 laps. And I named the company 21 Laps because it was that moment where I realized, oh, wait, this person is not everything and only what I thought they were. And that was my goal with 21 Laps, is that we're not what you thought we were. And now I don't even have to say it because you see the body of work. And it's like, guess what? We're capable of surprising.
And do you like that? I mean, both Stranger Things and Arrival are surprises of a certain kind. I mean, you really don't know what you're getting into with Stranger Things at all, but Arrival, much more female energy and much more, that's almost, and which Denis has not done quite so much in the past. Is there a certain pleasure in having people come out of the theater or come off the TV screen seeing something that they didn't expect?
Speaking to Arrival, 100%, because I think people are thinking they're going in and seeing a certain type of film, and I think they're to a degree seeing that, but they're coming out being surprised and moved, And what the number one thing we hear is what an emotional experience it is, and you don't get that with sci-fi. And so yes, it people absolutely, when they come out, they seem blown away and genuinely moved, and that's really satisfying.
Yeah, and it is nice kind of subverting expectations and kind of creating and delivering to an audience something that they didn't, it's not only what they weren't expecting, but they didn't kind of know what they were going to get. And in a culture where it's very hard to create a singular, unique, fresh story and experience, and it's certainly the kind we aspire to.
So is this the best moment for you so far?
I mean, definitely 2016 is the year where a lot of hard work and a lot of aspiration is coming to fruition, and it's very satisfying. And I'm also old enough to enjoy it. I'm also old enough to know that when these moments happen, slow down and savor it a little.
And I would say this, I think it's so far it is absolutely the most enjoyable time, and hopefully if you ask us this again in December,
yeah. It'll
even be even better. We have another film with John Hamburg coming out, we'll have a rival out in the world, and so yeah, it seems like it's shaping up to be a great year.
So will you have the emotional connection with something like YM that you have with a rival?
Well, you know what, YM is another multi-year journey, and it's the movie itself is funny and incredibly warm, and Cranston and Franco are magic together. The movie is less emotional because it's a comedy versus a sci-fi drama, but I will tell you, when you believe in something, and this isn't any line of work, you believe in it, you lean into it, you do the work knowing you may get no reward. No one may notice, no one may care. You do the work because that's the way we live. That's the way we live, and that is the way Dan and I, we believe that if you're a grown-up in this world and you're passionate about something, you bleed for it. You outwork everyone. And that is what we do at the labs. And so the movie is less emotional because it's a comedy, but the achievement is not less gratifying. The achievement of, we said we were going to do that and that we were going to make it great and we did it. That's equally emotional.
And making people laugh is a really, really great feeling.
Yeah, that too.
So for all the benefits of making movies and succeeding in that regard, it sounds like being able to continue working and doing this thing that you love is almost a greater reward.
Well, being able to keep working is absolutely a reward, but we only bother working on things we love. So work for its own sake means nothing to me. Right? We've done well as a company, so we can say yes or no. That's not going to make or break us. We only say yes to things that are irresistible and that we think we can contribute in a meaningful way. And if it doesn't meet that threshold of belief, we pass.
Because it is a multi-year commitment. It could be 5-6 years of your life.
Yeah, no, it's for real.
So you have to love them.
Yeah.